Archaeology is not just about digging up the past. It's also about interpreting the past and reconstructing the past. Through studying ground plans and preserved timber from waterlogged sites, archaeologists interpret this information and attempt to build Iron Age-style roundhouses. These three roundhouses are all based on different interpretations of the same excavation, with evidence coming from the waterlogged site of Glastonbury Lake Village, discovered and excavated by Arthur Bullard in the 1890s. Glastonbury Lake Village was built by Iron Age people over 2,000 years ago on an island in the marshy wetland environment of the Somerset Levels. Damien Goodburn from the Musuem of London believes our Iron Age ancestors lived in beehive-shaped, woven wattle houses. Jonathan West from Butser Ancient Farm is of the opinion that Iron Age houses had vertical walls with separate conical roofs.
Butser Ancient Farm is located about 5 miles south of Petersfield in Hampshire. We're mostly interested in agriculture and the buildings of these Iron Age people. We're making constructs from archaeological evidence, which after all is just a ground level display of holes and slots from which we have to construct a three-dimensional building. This is our Glastonbury Lake Village house. We built it as a comparison and a contrast to our dry chalkland houses which we've concentrated on before. In order to construct a house like this, one has to consider the available materials. You can't just cut any old material from a wildwood situation. You've got to have managed woodland in order to be able to produce the materials to make a house of this sort. So this is the bulrush. It's a much longer plant than the wheat straw, and so that has some effect on the construction of the roof. It grows in waterlogged conditions, available in the Somerset Levels, so very much a natural material to use for a Glastonbury Lake Village house. The pitch of the roof is also important. If you build one of these roofs too flat, then obviously enough they can leak. The water doesn't have a chance to shed off the edge. If you build it too pointy, you also get the interesting effect where the water runs off so fast, it can actually dig a gully around the perimeter of the house on what we call the drip line. If you look above me here at the top of the wall, there's a gap between the thatched roof and the top of the wattle and daub. In the vernacular, this is known as a soffit, and this is a very important constructional detail. We haven't filled in these soffits, which is fundamentally wrong if you want to live in the house. So these soffits would have been sealed with an organic material and then daub spread over the top, and that would make the smoke inside the house much more manageable. Now I'd like to point out the spacing between these purlins. It's much wider than it would normally be. This is the seed head of the rush, and the stem of the plant is right outside here on the outer perimeter of the roof. Because it's such a tall, long plant, we don't need the purlins at such close spacing as we would have to do if this was wheat straw. So it's a saving on materials. Onto the door frame. We've constructed this as exactly as we can, given the well-preserved wood in Glastonbury Lake Village. We've got socketed joints here for the door hinge, and we've got a mortise and tenon holding the lintel on top of the door post. As you can see here, we've got contrasting methods of the purlins in the roof. Up here we've got a woven bit where the rods are used to weave in and out of the roof rafters. And below it you can see the method familiar to us where the purlins are tied on with fibre. We now realise that if we took out every other rafter and reduced the diameter, that we would have been able to continue the wattling right up to the apex. We find a considerable number of visitors coming to Butser will often mention an African connection. there's 53 different countries in Africa. There's all sorts of different ecosystems, from dry desert through to very, very humid jungle, and all these different materials from which you can build a round dwelling, certainly. Yes, superficially they are the same sort of shape, but they're temporary dwellings, not lived in for any great length of time. So Africa is too big a word, and we're more subtle than that.
Basically, there seem to be two competing theories. One is based on accidentally appropriating ideas about houses from Africa, which grew up in the 19th century as a result of archaeologists working in the colonial service and the army and so on in places like Africa, seeing round buildings and basically plonking what they saw on top of the post-hole plans they were excavating. And if one looks west into the most Celtic parts of Europe, i.e. Ireland, Western Scotland and that sort of general area, there's a quite distinctly different tradition of building there, which we can still see in the surviving vernacular buildings of those regions. And that I would label the Celtic solution. The key thing is that I think you can see a tradition of building in the Celtic West that just about survives, where the idea is that the walls of the building gradually run into the roof line. So there's no angle with vertical walls and a sloping roof. And if you look closely at the evidence, and say Deer Park Farms, for example, it seems as if the walls could easily taper into some kind of conical roof. So following on from the Deer Park Farms archaeological evidence, one can look to the ethnographic evidence, the surviving craft traditions in Ireland, in the building of boats upside down using a wattling technique with a sort of domed roof-like structure for the framing. The same with the basketry techniques. The only people in Europe to make baskets traditionally upside down with the vertical element stuck in the ground, in the same way they build the boats, in the same way I would suggest they build the houses. There are some other strands of evidence, like the wattle formwork you can see in medieval stone buildings in the west of Ireland, which creates a domed vault structure out of hazel rods, which you can still see preserved in the mortar. There are other strands of evidence. One other is the early sketchy drawings in the 16th century of the wattle palaces of the Wild Irish and so on. The first real experiments in this new way of looking at Celtic roundhouses in later prehistory is Tristan Barham. There have been other limited efforts, but Tristan Barham's group have been building these kind of beehive, continuous wall and roof buildings based on wattlework structures. And I've seen a couple of them, and I'm very interested by them. I think more work needs to be done in the subject, but they are quite convincing. I think with the larger buildings, clearly some more internal support is needed, but we do have parallels elsewhere in the world for dome-roofed, round-plan buildings which have a ring of inner posts. There are, in the ethnographic literature, in North America, for example, several examples of what I'm suggesting for the larger houses. A great danger with perpetuating this rather fixed idea about what late prehistoric round buildings look like is that it becomes the adopted model that everyone uses, and people stop focusing tightly on the archaeological evidence. Now, I'll give you a very clear example of that. In the vast majority of the elements of the roof structure are tied together with bits of string. But as far as I am aware, there is absolutely no archaeological evidence for this tradition of woodwork. Another reason why the African model has been adopted in a wholesale way is because it needs considerably less skill to actually put up one of those buildings, which is why it's a suitable project for schools and so on. The Celtic model requires somewhat more skill in wattle work and careful weaving. It also requires much better quality raw materials and more of them. I don't profess to have a perfect solution to the problem. I just feel that we should be more honest about the other strands of evidence that can be brought into this story and present them more evenly and fairly to the public, and stop unthinkingly perpetuating what is essentially a myth. We don't have very good evidence, and where we do have it, the best evidence we have from sites like Deer Park Farms, it really is not pointing in the direction of the African solution.
The stimulation that I receive from working at Butser is wonderful. We don't have all the answers. There are many questions always being posed, and this is why we do experimental archaeology.
The more we learn, the more we realise we don't know. New knowledge sheds new light on accepted theories, and reinterpretation is a necessary development to more accurately reflect how our ancestors lived in the past.